Because we have a million flammable acres right here in South Florida, and we have a lot of resources, both in terms of natural resources, visitor resources, economic activities outside the park, and given the place is that flammable as it is, the Park Service needs to have a concerted, coordinated staff and an effort to manage fire on this ecosystem. You know, managing fire in the modern landscape, we have to consider much more than our forefathers did or the Native Americans that came before us. So one of the reasons why we think about fire and we apply fire here is to really supplement fire's role here, and we do it at a time of our choosing as much as possible. Of course, we have no control when we get lightning, but with prescribed fire and the fires that we light, we can do it at a time of year where it's advantageous to us. In other words, this place is going to burn whether we do it or not, so let's try to choose the times that work for a multiple of objectives, whether they're wildlife objectives, hazard objectives, to reduce the risk of unwanted fires.
Temperature 65 degrees, relative humidity 58%, winds 10 miles per hour from the north-northwest with gusts to 19.
Good morning. Thanks to everybody for being out here and participating on this burn. I'm the burn boss trainee. Roger's the official burn boss. And today this unit here is called the Boy Scout Camp. It's approximately about 100 acres in size.
We usually do this in the shade since it's cloudy out today. You don't really have to worry about finding it. But when you get out in the prairie, there's no trees, so usually I bring an umbrella with me and kind of look like Mary Poppins out there.
And you have to do this in the habitat? That's mm-hmm. why you came over here?
Yep, the habitat that you're going to burn, so you get a good accurate reading.
Well, that's one.
Consumption.
I'd say it's a successful test burn. What about firing and holding?
Yeah. Are you guys good with that? Gary, let's sign off our go, no go, and we'll proceed with our burn.
Well, what we've got a wind, and we changed up our tactics. We went in behind instead of lighting off the shrub row, which we wanted to do. We came in behind and lit it. We're getting a push from the wind, and it's pushing into these shrubs with more heat, better fire behavior. We're getting better consumption.
Is it killing those shrubs?
It's not going to kill them. Shrubs are hard to kill. They'll re-sprout, but so be it. We've getting them down to that desirable height where it's going to allow a herbaceous layer to come in. Underneath of them, as opposed to before, that's all you had there is shrubs.
We have the perfect parameters or weather. Everything's staying in line with our prescription. And if you look out there, we've got real nice consumption of all the fuels, meaning everything is not being totally consumed. What we've already burned, there's pockets of unburned fuel. So we're getting a mosaic pattern in the burn.
We're in the Boy Scout camp, which is inside Everglades National Park. It's one of the most beautiful stands of pine that we have here. It gets frequent fire. The wildflower pulse, as we say, was pretty incredible. It was really beautiful to see the pinks, the yellows, the purples. But we see how robust this is and how green it is. And we can see it in all the vegetation throughout. We see the ash on the ground, and we see tons of little seedlings, fresh new growth. If we burnt the top of this coon tea off, there is so much, and this is where all the starch is located, beyond this crown. There's so much of the plant underground. It gets the nutrient pulse from the ash, and it'll just resprout. You can tell right here where this was one of the fronds. It burned off. These are the new ones that came back over and over again. Who knows how old this coon tea is?
Will it ever be killed by a fire?
Unlikely. Again, these plants are built to burn. It has so much because heat doesn't penetrate the soil very deeply.
And how long does it take these plants to regenerate after a fire?
They start almost immediately. When I'm looking at fire, I'm watching combustion at work, so to speak, in that physical process. But also, you're watching an ancient process at work. Watching a fire graze, so to speak, through the pinelands, depositing its ash and changing the landscape, opening up for more sunlight, putting more nutrients down. And I know that there's going to be a beauty after this place is blackened. The beauty I see is in the contrast, that stark difference between black and green. It gives me that immediate sense of hope, renewal, change, continuity, and it just seems like this will go on forever. It's birth and death in the Everglades. I can observe directly that without fire, the pine rocklands are somewhat less of pine rocklands. Fire is the blood of the pine rocklands. When fire pulses through this landscape, the pine rocklands are alive. And that's how I know it's healthy.